Charulata is actually one of my favorite Ray films, and it's actually one film with packed with so many iconic. There are so many iconic moments in this film. I actually saw it after a long time now, and just the way the camera is framing her, the little activity she's doing, everything. There's so much detail. The first shot, she's sewing. She's I think embroidering some kind of an initial on the thing. I don't know, it just made me feel, it kind of said something about a role of a woman in a certain period. You see her, she gets up, and then you see how the camera focuses on the production design, which gives you a sense of the aristocratic, the rich background probably she's coming from. There is this sense of boredom in the scene. You know, she goes to pick up a book, so you immediately know that there is. That she's probably learned, she's interested in literature. But you know, that just that first image that really makes you feel that she's capable, or maybe she has so much desires of doing something else. So that little moment of when she sits on that grand piano and she just plays those two notes, there's almost like you know, you felt like she aspires to do, and then it stops at the two notes. There is this void. And maybe it's only limited to aspiration, but it start. I think like that first image is very important because it says everything about the place of a woman in that society and probably at that time. And subsequently, every shot adds so much detail and so much information. I mean, on a philosophical level also, like you know, the way it's framed. There's so much. If you notice, there's so much of negative frame. It's almost like frame like that, you know, everything. So it's kind of focusing on how all of this is, you know, the house and everything is so much bigger than her. Like she's almost like this bird who's like trapped. She's in a cage. She's hopping from one window to another.
I would like to share a few observations from writing point of view. So we see a cage hanging there in the balcony. So the cage as an image has been introduced. Then the binocular, which has to play a very important role in the film, that little prop is going to be a, you know, it will feature in the poster eventually. So that binocular is introduced, which for me is not only a sign of a childlike innocence or fascination, it is also a sign of something that is forbidden, because she's using the binoculars to be a peeping Tom, to look, to observe people from dark. Charulata in many ways is a forbidden love story, right? So it is a kind of a forbidden thing is introduced because she's using it to be a peeping Tom, to observe other people who are unaware of her, right? So that binocular has been introduced. Then I was, maybe I'm reading too much into this, but her repetition of Bankim, Bankim, Bankim tells us that she reads Bankim and she is well read. But also, even when it comes to the titles of the book, it is Bankim, 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 which means there is a certain monotony there as well. And then the title that she chooses is Kapal Kundala, and I read about it. Kapal Kundala is a story written by Bankim about a forest-dwelling girl who falls in love with a married man. So there's a forbidden romance going on there as well. And this forest girl then comes to live in the city and she feels out of place in the city. Okay? And this girl who is a city girl is feeling out of place in this house. So Kapal Kundala has a strong, metaphor there. These are the things which I felt from a writing point of view, these things were, you know, insist like we were explicitly shown. But yeah. As a writer, if I'm not the director of this sequence, as a writer, I would be terribly scared that the first 6 pages of my script are doing nothing. And we don't see any other character. This is to, we should notice this, that she hears people and she watches them from a distance. But even when she interacts with someone, we don't see that person. So we only see that woman.
Actually, Satyanshu, if you would have gone maybe a few seconds further into the film, there's a very interesting shot of the husband. The husband character is introduced. He walks past her, almost not noticing she's even there. And there's a little subtle humor moment in it where she also like plonks up the binocular and looks at her husband. So it almost makes you feel like the husband is also, you know, she has that little outsider view of him, like, you know, how she looks at this outside world. And probably she, at some point of time in her life, she had access to that world, and she's now only had that distant view of that world, which is outside, because she's from a probably certain background and she's locked in that house.
One thing which really catches our attention is the camera movements, because one way of looking at any film is just to focus on all the choices that the director did not make. Like a lot of Asian filmmakers, a lot of European filmmakers, when they start this film, many masters, when they start something like this, they would have still shots, stillness of frame, you know, and just making things very still for us to enhance the monotony. You know, why do you think we have so many dynamic, almost, you know, on the face camera movements very early in the film, when we are more likely to notice them?
I personally felt like, you know, the camera was trying to almost, like, in a very subtle way, capture the energy of the character. Like, probably she's got, a lot of this desire to do things, but her space is limited. This is it. Like, you know, this is where it will. So almost, I felt like the camera is almost adding that energy which she has, but she's not able to take it out, you know, in that whole mundane, limited space which is there. I think one of the concepts that the film is trying to explore is Charulata coming in terms and finding her power as a female. Like, you know, it's almost like her becoming Durga, you know, and it's a great design. And there are these like very like dramatic movements and a lot of lateral movements.
I'm reminded of something which we constantly try to do in our writing, that when you're creating a character and you want the audience to be rooted, invested in the character, you must make sure that the audience must empathize with the character, but not sympathize with the character. We should not feel pity for the character. We should empathize with the character. We should put ourselves in her shoes. So after listening to you, and this is like my observation right now, I may be wrong, if we were extremely still throughout, kind of we are asking the audience to feel her sadness. But if we are more playful, we are asking the audience to focus on her possibilities, on her dreams, her aspirations, which makes a character more empathetic rather than sympathetic or pitiful.
Yeah, and that's such a beautiful way of looking at it, you know.
Cool. I think we can talk more about it, but if we stop it here, it's like teasing the students with just the right amount of information and inspiring them to go and watch Charulata.